Welcome to Spiritual Living with Barbara Schreiner-Trudel. I am delighted to be back with you today. I want to talk a little bit today about what spirituality is and what it isn't. I think sometimes we get confused and we think of spirituality and we tie it to religion, and it isn't that. Spirituality is about the divine essence within us and how we allow our true nature, our authentic self, out. Part of that journey is about forgiveness. I've written a book called 30 Days of Forgiveness, and it is a journal, it is a process, because we have to do it every day. There's always something that happens or something that goes on. We're upset with someone or with ourselves, and forgiveness is a powerful way of changing that and altering it. It also allows us to discover our true and authentic nature, our power, our purpose for life and living. We have to let go of the past in order to move forward. So I invite you to check out my website to order the book and do the practice, because it really is a powerful way of changing your life and getting yourself to that place of true power, potential, and possibility. I am delighted today to have the remarkable Aina-Nia with me as my guest. She is the founder of Sacred Women International. She's a renowned leadership development trainer. She's remarkable. She's my friend. I love her. She's worked in leadership development for over 2 decades, and all over the world she travels. She works with women, empowering women to discover their true potential and possibility. Aina-Nia is currently traveling to cities around the planet to fulfill her calling to support women in the process of remembering their power and claiming the life that they envision. How exciting is that? In the summer of 2015, she completed production on her documentary television series called Remembering the Power. I'm really excited to hear about that. She studied under Dr. Engel in Yanla Van Zandt. I always have trouble with that. Yanla Van Zandt. My apologies, Ayanla, I do know how to say your name, but so I'm really excited, because I know that the work that Aina-Nia is doing is profound for women. It is profound for our planet. I know that each one of us plays a part in what happens in the unfolding of this incredible place that we live in. And I know that her work is really making a big difference. So please help me welcome Aina-Nia. Hello, darling.
Hello, my dear.
I'm so glad you could join me. And tell me a little bit about Sacred Woman and what that work is all about that you're doing.
So Sacred Women is really, as you know, this community. It's a community, yeah, of love. It's a community of power. It's a community of women. And really came out of, Sacred Women was born out of a need to allow women space. Allow women space to feel safe. Mm-hmm. Allow women space to be all of who she is.
Right.
Every single piece, bring it into this awesomeness and this divineness that they are. And about really allowing women who lead, however that leadership shows up, to lead from a full cup.
Okay.
To lead from a place of filling up yourself first, being full, having self-fullness,
so that you can share.
So that we can share with, yeah, the world. So it's a community that has been growing and healing and doing,
it's exciting,
and doing great work.
I think one of the challenges with all of us as women is that we do forget that we're powerful. Mm-hmm. We play into the limitations. We, you know, be martyrs, or we beat ourselves up for not being perfect or whatever. And I think the work you're doing is pretty profound, mm-hmm, because it makes a difference. Mm-hmm. I think it's really important as women that we recognize we are powerful. We're also the majority of the population, so I think we should start acting like it.
Yeah, 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 and we are. We are tremendously powerful,
yeah,
by virtue of who, of how we are created.
Yes,
you know,
yes, exactly.
By virtue of how we are created, by virtue of how we are naturally and what we give birth to, which,
right,
is the rest of the world. Yes,
yes.
So that alone, we're just so magnificently powerful.
So tell me about your documentary.
So Remembering Her Power really is exactly that. We did a series, did a production in L.A., mm-hmm, on a 6-day series where we took women from a diverse ethnicity, place in their life, ages. Really, these women were women who were ready to take this next step.
Okay.
Right? Whatever mm-hmm. that meant.
Yes.
And so we did a casting, we did interviews, and we selected 7 women to come on a journey with us. And basically what we did was take the Sacred Leaders Training Program, which is, as you know, our flagship program that has been running since 2009, took our 10-month program yeah. and condensed it into 7 days.
Oh my goodness. That had to be intense.
Oh my goodness. And documented that.
Yes.
That's one piece of it. But the yeah. documentary really is about my journey.
Oh, okay.
It's really about my journey into stepping into my power
right.
and standing in my power and the work that I do with women to support them in doing exactly that.
And so tell me a little bit about your journey.
So, you know, when you ask that question, I reflect and I'm thinking, okay, which part of the journey? So I'll talk about what I see as my journey into conscious living.
Right. Okay.
You know, mm-hmm. and yes. Several years ago, and it's interesting that you're talking about forgiveness, because I think my journey and my rebirth came out of unforgiveness.
Okay.
You know?
Okay, yeah.
It came out of being in a place of unforgiveness that then the universe said, well, girl, you need to do some things. Let me just shake you up and wake you up so you can forgive and get on with it, right?
Yes.
And so I had a very serious car accident. But prior to the car accident, my stepfather had died, mm-hmm. and which was a pivotal point for me because that was also a very painful experience for me, right?
Okay.
My life with him was a painful experience,
right?
So his death brought up a lot of stuff for me. I didn't know it then. I wasn't
yes.
conscious enough to know that's what was going on. But right. I remember getting really angry. Angry
okay.
that he had died and I hadn't gotten to fix him, you know?
yes, yes.
So his death happened, and then 14 days after, my birth father died. And in that period of in that 14-day period, I was so angry about my life that I lived as a child, and what role my father played or did not play in that. So the anger spilled over to him,
right.
and I was his caretaker. I was one of his main caretaker,
mm-hmm.
and he died with me not seeing him up to more than 5 days before his passing, right? And I would
right.
normally have been doing that. So there was a number of things that happened, and then my car accident.
So the universe was really giving you a
girl
cosmic sledgehammer to the head.
Whoop, 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 right?
Time to wake up.
So a series of things
yeah.
happened. For me, the car accident was a rebirth.
Okay.
Because it was a very, very serious car accident, and in fact, had me on my back for a very long period, right?
Hmm.
I tried to work, I tried to get back into normal, and nothing was happening. The good news is, when you're laying on your back and you're in pain and you have nothing to do, you start to reflect.
You start to think. That something's got to change.
Something's
exactly.
got to change. And I went to my chiropractor one day, and I saw Science of Mind magazine
mm.
in his office, and I started to read it. And
yes.
in that magazine was a story of Christopher Reeves.
Ah, yes, yes.
And his accidents.
Yeah.
And his journey.
Yeah.
And that started me on a journey of reflection.
Right.
And the universe continued to send me more stories like Christopher Reeves and more books and more angels and more angels. And my life just started to shift.
Yeah.
And I made a very conscious choice to work on me.
I think that's the journey, right? The spiritual journey is remembering that we're spiritual beings, that the essence of us, that part has not been touched, but the human frailty, the finite part of ourselves that we tend to attach to can be very painful sometimes, and mm-hmm. making that shift mm-hmm. can be really difficult. Because I know when I found the Science Mind teaching, it was after two very violent marriages that mm-hmm. were physically, mentally, emotionally, financially abusive, and waking up one day going, what role have I played in creating this?
Yep.
And it required the act of forgiveness to really begin to live a more powerful mm-hmm. life, and to go, what do I want to create now? Mm-hmm. Do I want something different, or do I want to continue being somebody's punching bag? Like, what am I going to do? Mm-hmm. And it's interesting how when we do start that journey of awakening, how fast things move, but also how it ramps stuff up as well. Mm-hmm. All the things we've been resisting mm-hmm. come to the surface, mm-hmm. and we can look at them and begin to release them, or we can crawl back into our shell and say, poor me,
yep.
and be back in that victim state. And I think forgiveness isn't really something that I needed to do for the men in my life. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness was something mm-hmm. I had to do for me. And it was about letting go of the past so I could be in the present moment, so I could create something new in the mm-hmm, future. Mm-hmm, it's mm-hmm. a big job.
It's a huge job. And you know, in that shifting, like you said, do we crawl back under the covers and just stay there?
Right.
Or do we make a choice to do whatever it takes to move forward? And sometimes yeah. it's both.
Yes.
Sometimes we crawl back under, we get up, we crawl back under, we get up. Sometimes
yeah,
we do
absolutely.
That dance until we learn how to stand fully in it.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
But the journey, and the journey continues.
Forever. If we're drawing a breath, we're on a journey.
Yeah, yeah. It truly continues, you know, and enlightenment. I keep thinking about this whole idea of enlightenment and its process. You mm-hmm. know, and it's like there are levels to this enlightenment.
Yes.
Because the things that I would do, or the thoughts that I would have 10 years ago, mm-hmm. maybe even 1 year ago, I no longer need to have those
exactly.
thoughts. Right?
Exactly.
So I'm at another level, and the journey just continues. But this place of taking responsibility for my life.
Yeah.
And taking responsibility to live my greatest life. Taking responsibility to find out who I really am.
Yes.
You know, and the day that I got to the place that, you know, I am all of that. I am loud.
Yes.
I'm quiet.
Yes.
Right?
Just like me.
Just like you. I love to be naked, and I love lots of clothes. You know, all of these different yeah. ways that I show up in the world.
Yes.
I am intense.
Yes.
And I can be not intense too. All of these different things
yes.
are me. They're all parts of me, and it's okay to be all of them.
I think that's one of the things that that we discover as we begin the journey of living more from our spiritual authentic self. We begin to see that all of us are light and dark. All of us have that dark side that's capable of pretty bad things, and that part of us that's the light. And it's, where are we paying attention?
Mm-hmm.
What is it that we're focusing our attention on?
Mm-hmm.
And I think the journey that we're on is really about reconciling the two things, because it is the two things that make us whole.
Yeah.
And when we bring a whole self into the world, we're actually looking after ourselves in a really good way. So we have our self-care, mm-hmm. which allows us to have the energy and the power and the presence to care for others as well. If I'm broken, I can't care for anyone. Like after your accident, you're flat on the back. You're
yep.
not caring for anybody.
Yep.
You can't.
I tell you, Barbara, I remember in that, because it was a few years of it consciously saying I'm shifting,
yes.
and the pain of that,
yes.
because one of the things that happened, and I'm sure on your walk you've probably had that too, is that there was a lot of giving up. I had to give up a lot of things, right?
Well, you give up everything.
Everything.
Yeah.
Everything that I knew my life to be.
Yes.
Everything. Right. Just so I'm think in everything, emptiness.
Yes.
To get to this place of emptiness and nakedness.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And I remember in those periods thinking, I just want peace.
Yes.
I don't know what that looks like.
Yeah.
But I just want peace.
Yes.
And peace for me became having less and less of things. Peace for me became resigning from a lot of things that I was involved in.
Right.
Where I was trying to take care of everybody.
Yeah. We have a habit of doing that.
Everybody.
Yes.
Yet that 4 o'clock in the morning me, that 4 o'clock in the morning where there yeah. is silence and there is nothing else but me and myself.
Yes.
Was tired.
Yeah.
And broken and empty.
Yes. And until you fill her up, you have nothing to give to anyone else. I know for me and I know for you that there's a vision of a peaceful world for us mm-hmm. to live in, a world of compassion and kindness and respect for all people at all times. And that comes from being full.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm full, I have the energy to love you.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm broken and hurting, and I mean, I had both hips replaced. I was flat on my back as well. And you know, it's interesting, you lay there and you think about life and you think about what you're doing and where you're going, and for a while you can do nothing. So while I could do nothing, I sat there and I had to go through that journey of, well, I need to do stuff, I need to earn a living, I need to look after my family, all these things that I needed to do that I was incapable of doing.
Yep.
I needed to learn to say, would you please help me? Oh, that was a tough one to swallow.
That's probably really what you needed.
That's exactly what I needed.
The lesson of
yeah.
saying, this is what I need.
Yes.
Please help me.
Please help me. Yeah.
Please help me.
I like
me.
To help people.
Yeah.
I'm not good at saying, please help me.
Right. So I remember when I had to learn to do that.
Yes.
Where I had to learn to say, sympathy. Yes, thank you.
Yes. Yes.
Yes, thank you. Yes, thank yeah. you sounds like such a simple thing to say.
Oh, yeah.
But for women, we're always giving.
Yes.
When somebody offers us something, oh, no, it's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Now I have learned how to say, yes, thank
yes.
you.
Yes, yes, thank
and
you.
And maybe I won't need all of what you want to give me, but I'm going to take some so I can train my body
yeah.
to receive.
Yes. I heard, I can't remember, it was on television or something, I heard about saying yes to everything for a while. And I thought, what a great idea yeah. for a week or so to just say yes to everything that comes along and what that might mean on our journey of awakening and discovery and how powerful or how frightening that might feel. But I think it would be a really interesting thing to do.
I have my students do that.
Yes.
Depending on where they are. They
yeah.
either go on a yes fast or a no fast.
Or a no fast, yes. Yeah.
And see what that's like to actually say yes. Because
yeah.
the universe is always saying yes to us.
I think we forget that. And I think that's part of the
yeah.
awakening or mm-hmm. the spiritual journey is realizing that the universe is actually a friendly place. That
yes.
The eternal power and presence of God or spirit or universe, whatever you want to call it, that energy is everywhere present. It's all powerful and it's within and as all of us.
Mm.
And so when we begin to accept that I am living in the universe. In fact, every cell of my body is part of the universe, as is yours. There is no separation between you and I. We are one. And coming to terms with that oneness is
that's the power.
Crazy powerful.
That's the power, Barbara.
And you never have to exert power on anybody else. You never need to be jealous or envious because you are dynamic, special, fabulous, and wonderful
mm-hmm.
just like me
yeah.
and just like everyone
yeah.
else. We are unique, divine, beautiful, special beings, and everyone has a reason for being here.
Yeah, that's the power. That's the remembering our power.
That's
when
awesome.
We get into this place, for me, that is my work on this planet, to remind people
yes.
that just who you are, just exactly what you said,
yes.
just who I am, Aina-Nia, just who you are, Barbara, is powerful.
Yeah, and it's enough.
And it's enough. And yes. All we have to do is be more and more and more of that power.
Yeah, yeah. It's accepting all of the little things about ourselves. It's, you know, looking at our past and going, well, it's done. I can't really change it. So it is what it is. And from there, moving forward, going, now what?
This morning, my prayer this morning, I woke up and I said, I am so grateful for every single experience I've ever had in my life.
Yes.
Everyone.
Yes.
Every.
Yes.
Abuse, betrayals, everything.
Yes.
Everything. I am so grateful because every experience that I've ever had in my life has formed me and has informed me.
It also allows you to really have empathy for the people that you come in contact with as you're working with women. Mm-hmm. You begin to understand their position. I've had people say to me, oh, you know, so-and-so just keeps going back to her husband even though he beats her, and I'm just done. And I look at them and go, you really don't need to be done. She's doing what she believes she must. And although you don't understand her reasons, I actually do understand why she goes back. And because I understand, I'm gonna love her where she is. And when she's ready, I will be there because I love her where she is. I know that at some point in time, if I love her enough, that maybe she'll love herself enough to make the shift, to make the change. But I can't buy into the idea that I'm gonna walk away from this individual because they just don't get it. Yeah. I'm not here to fix people. I'm here to love them where mm-hmm. they are, as they are. And my hope is that something said or done will inspire them to make the change, mm-hmm. whatever mm-hmm. change that might mm-hmm. be that they want to do in their mm-hmm. life.
But how do we know, how do we serve people without knowledge or experience?
That's exactly right. So the experience we have is perfect.
Exactly what we needed.
We couldn't do what we were doing if we didn't have it.
I remember there was a time in my life where I was, I had spent some years in finance.
Yes.
In money business. And I guess I was teaching it, and I was teaching it, and the universe needed me to get really good with this particular subject matter.
Yes. Yes.
As I taught it. Mm-hmm. And I got to a place where my money dried up so badly. So badly, Reverend Barbara, that I had I had experiences that I'd only read about in books or had clients tell me, and I would think that I can, you know, guide them somehow because I read something. And the universe thought, well, I have to make you get really good at this, Aina-Nia.
Yeah.
And gave me a money experience that I remember walking on the street one day and thinking, how am I going to feed my son? Like, seriously, how am I going to feed my son?
Yes, yes.
And get into the store.
Yeah.
And at that time, I was very much into vegetarian and vegan. That was my diet a lot, vegetarian and vegan diet. I found myself a chicken that was on sale. Mm-hmm. I raked that chicken. I cut it up. I pieced it up so much and packaged it for different days. Because my son was playing football at that time. When you have a teenager playing football.
Oh, they need so much.
They are hungry.
They are hungry all the time.
But I had to have that money experience.
Yes.
So that my students and my clients who were coming to me, that when I taught them, I was teaching them from a place of knowing.
Yeah, been there, done that.
Been there, done that.
Yeah.
And here is what you do. You praise in the pain.
Yes.
You give thanks for what is to come, knowing it's already done. That's when I learned the power of intention.
Intention is such a remarkable thing. If you get up in the morning and sit back and say, you know, today is a great day. I intend to be the best me that I can be. And then you watch how the day unfolds. You get to the end, there's so much to be grateful for, because regardless of what came our way, we showed up fully. Mm-hmm. And in showing up fully, mm-hmm. we managed it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Things changed or moved as a result of the energy that we brought. But intention creates a pathway.
Intention, forgiveness,
gratitude,
love.
Yeah,
because I also realized that I had to forgive my judgments.
Oh yeah,
on myself and on
and others. Yeah, I get quite judgmental when I'm driving. And I have to remind myself that I too have made mistakes when I'm driving. I have cut someone off at some point in time or another, or been slow off the start, or, you know, raced through that yellow light. Yeah. And so my journey the last few weeks has been to go, bless you, I love you, it's all good.
I'm not going to cuss you right now.
Well, I haven't fully accomplished it yet, but I'm
You're getting there, right? I'm working on it.
Yeah. I'm aware that, I'm really aware when I do it, and then I stop and go, no, just bless, just bless. Because any judgment I hold comes from a judgment I have on myself. Everything comes from me.
Yes.
And that's a powerful thing when we look at our life and go, wow, you know, Shakespeare said, you know, we're all actors on a stage. And I thought, what if that's like real? What if that's real? Hmm. That we're doing what we're doing, but it's we could all do it different because we're the writer, the director, the actor, the stage manager.
Yep.
We're all of it.
It's our life.
It's our life. And we can begin to shape it according to what we believe and how we feel, most importantly about ourselves first.
Yes.
If I love me, I can love you.
I love that song. I love myself so much that I can love you so much that you can love you so much that you can start loving me.
Aren't we great? Oh, I'm sure we're going to have a record contract after that. But it's
you
such a great message.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that was, I think Ricky Byers, Beckwith wrote that. And yeah, it's a really powerful message because if I love myself enough, I have it. It's like if you ask me for $1 million, I got to say no.
Right.
Not because I don't want to give it to you, but because I don't have it right now, right? If I don't have love, how am I going to love you? If I can't show compassion and respect for me and my journey, how can I show compassion and respect for yours? Right? It's we really have to, I think as a child, I don't know if you got this message, but the message I got as a child was, don't be so self-centered. Who do you think you are?
Yep.
Don't be selfish.
Yep. Yep.
So we learn to give all our good away rather than to go, wow, I am a unique and remarkable individual, and I'm going to bring that to the world.
Mm-hmm.
And so we got afraid and we pulled back
rather
than shining.
Because that was selfish.
And instead, I think it's selfish actually to hold back our essence, to hold back our gifts and talents.
Yeah.
I think that's what's selfish, and I think it's what's killing us too.
It's definitely what's killing us.
It's true.
It's definitely, because even if we think about it, the tension.
Yes.
You know, the tension that caused when we have to hold back. And women say that to me all the time.
Yes.
I had to dim my light. I had to kind of dim who I am. Women talk about that all
the time.
Time.
All
the time. To the place where they perfect it.
Yeah.
They perfect what it means to hold themselves back.
Yeah, and it's when you think about that, then we're raising babies who are going to do the same thing.
Yes, Barbara.
We have created a world where mediocrity is what people are striving for.
Yeah.
How frightening is that?
Yep.
I want to fit in so bad, I'm going to shut down the very essence of my being so people might like me.
Yeah.
Might.
Mm-hmm.
They probably won't, but but might.
And be somebody else and live somebody else's values.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
Live the values that's been dictated.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, before we came on here, we were talking about how journalism has changed, right? And the opinion. So everybody has an opinion. These opinions then become everybody else's opinion. So where am I in that? We get lost.
Well, I think we look at life, and one event, news event that stood out for me was when the soldier was shot on Parliament Hill in Ottawa. And the journalists were talking about, you know, had that sergeant not shot the gunman, you know, what if it had gone into this room, and what if he'd gone into that room, and this was going on, and what if he'd gone there? Hello, what if didn't happen? Let's talk about what happened, and let's leave it at that. I was talking to my daughter, who's 12, and I was talking to her the other day, or a week or two ago, because she was saying, well, what if, and I went, no, we don't do what if, because what if didn't occur. It didn't happen. Imagination is a remarkably powerful faculty that all of us have. Mm-hmm. And when we use it in a fear mode, we create all manner of discord in our lives and in others. Yeah. And it's a, you know, I talked last week about, you know, you drop a pebble into a pond and the ripples go on and on.
Yeah.
If my ripples are fear, is that what I want my children to know? Is that what I want the women I work with or the men I work with, the people in my congregation, is that what I want them to live their mm-hmm. lives from? Is fear and doubt and worry?
Mm-hmm. And we're in a very fear-filled world.
Oh my goodness, we need to shut the TV off. Not this one.
Keep this one. We live in a fear-filled world where everything that comes out of somebody's mouth is that.
Yeah.
Is what can happen. Well, what about creating and having an imagination of something beautiful?
Yeah,
what
something beautiful.
What
something,
if? Yeah. What if it wasn't fear?
Yeah.
What if it wasn't?
What if it was love?
What if it was love?
What would happen if everywhere we went, every person we talked to, we allowed our heart to open so that we could find that person rather than putting up a wall going, they might be bad or mean or whatever, and instead go, huh, talk to me about you, who are you, and have a conversation. I met a gentleman on the street a couple of weeks ago. I was coming out of the vets. I was buying food for my dog, and I'm coming out, and there's a gentleman on the street, and I didn't have any change or anything, but we stood and chatted and had this great conversation. He was a really sweet man. And I watched other people who were walking by and kind of turning away and trying not to get too close to him for fear he asked them for something. And I thought, you can say no. Hmm. And you can say, good morning, how are you today? And isn't it lovely? And just begin to have a conversation, and you begin to find these people and you learn about them. I met with a young man who was, you know, struggling to find himself, and I said, you are so beautiful, and you are so remarkable, and so, so articulate. Give that and begin to watch how things start to change for you. And that's the journey that we're mm-hmm. on, is looking at ourselves, forgetting all the messages we got as kids, mm-hmm. and looking at ourselves as who we really are. An exercise that I give to my students is to look in the mirror and look into your own eyes, and as you look into your own eyes, say, I love you. I really love you. I have women who can't do it even once. Mm-hmm. Even as I stand beside them and mm-hmm. tell them how remarkable they are, and they're looking in the mirror and tears rolling down their mm-hmm. faces, and they can't get mm-hmm. the words out. And it's heartbreaking to see that place. And yet, I was there.
Yep.
I was there. I'm not there anymore.
Yep.
Thank you, God.
But imagine being told every single day
you're not enough.
That you're not enough. Mm-hmm. And then imagine telling yourself that you're not enough.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's the self-acceptance, you know. I always tell my students, I give them nothing to do that I've not done.
Yes.
So as I watched my own body, I watched my body change. And I remember thinking, where did this new body come from? Like, I don't even know how to dress this body anymore. Right?
Yes, I know the feeling.
I don't know how to dress this body anymore. And I decided, I'm going to fall in love with this body.
Yeah.
I'm gonna fall in love with this body. And the first thing I did was take a picture of myself naked. Because I needed to look at her and love her.
Yes.
Just the way she is.
Just the way she is.
Because you see, when
this
we
is
do,
a temple.
Oh, this beautiful temple. This beautiful temple who now has a bigger ass and a bigger belly and bigger boobs. This beautiful temple.
Isn't it gorgeous?
And so, right? And so what that does then, and I share this with women especially, because what that does then is that when somebody says to me, including people that I love,
yes,
say, oh my goodness, Aina-Nia, you've gotten so fat, or whatever.
Right.
I can stand in my glory. I can stand in my beauty, and I can say, I am good. And truly mean it.
And truly mean it. Absolutely.
Because I spend time falling in love with this new body. I say that to say, that's the power. We need to love exactly where we are, how it is.
Yes.
Right now.
Right now.
Right now. So that when someone with their own judgments and their own projections,
yes,
come upon us and say we're not good enough, that we can stand and say, but I am.
And we can smile at them and say, yeah, thank you for sharing.
Yeah.
You know, it's okay. Your opinion is fine. And I don't have to believe that for me.
So they don't take it in.
Exactly. Exactly, yeah. Right. Exactly right. It's such an interesting journey. I know, you know, I have four children, and my eldest is 44, and my youngest is 12. So there's a, you know, little...
very, very slight gap.
A little gap there.
You brave woman.
I'm not sure if it was bravery or stupidity, but she's the greatest gift I've ever been given. Is to have that girl in my life now. And she, you know, she is such a remarkable young woman because she really believes, you know, what I think about, I bring about, that as I journey along and I start thinking about my life, I know that it's going to have an impact, that those thoughts actually are moving the energy of the universe into action. And so what is it that I'm thinking about? And now she's in grade 7, and it's a little tougher because her friends are saying, do this, do that, here's how you get a boy, and these things. And she's like, I don't know about that. And I said, you don't need to get a boy at 12 years old or a girl or whatever. You don't need
to get anybody.
And you don't ever need to get anybody. At some point in time, you are going to meet people you are in alignment with, and those people are going to love you for you. Not because you flirted or you wore, you know, a certain type of clothing. They're going to love your humor and your incredible singing voice and all of these things, right? She has so many gifts. And I look at her and I go, what a blessing. My eldest daughter is now studying for ministry. And she said, how long does it take? I said, does it matter? You know, somebody once said, I think it might have been Confucius, you know, when is the best time to plant a tree? Well, 20 years ago. Second best time? Now. And we're, as we journey along, it's finding our voice and finding our rhythm. And I know my eldest daughter sent me some stuff she had written, and it was so, so beautiful and rich. And I thought, wow, you know, she came from a 16-year-old, and she's arrived here. Like, wow, what a powerful, creative young woman. And I'm so blessed. I didn't make her. She made her. I probably messed her up big time, but but I always loved her, and I love her so much. And I know that that has been a healing journey for both of us because our ages were so close, right? That we were really more friends than we were mother and daughter. Mm-hmm. And so it created a different experience for me. And my sons is different because I was a little older when I had them. I was in my mid-20s. But then having Genevieve at 48, now that's a whole nother kettle of fish.
She's got a whole different mother.
She's got a whole different mother because I recognize that my only responsibility is to provide a container for her to realize herself. And I'm in the process of doing that for me. And I think that's what you teach is, come on, beautiful, glorious women, find your voice, find your authentic self and let go of the past and move forward.
And because, you know, all our children, your turn, my turn, all our children and everyone, we have a contract.
Yes.
We came into this world for a particular purpose.
Yes. What is yours?
It's to teach.
Teach.
I heal through teaching.
Yes. Yeah.
So I am always teaching. It doesn't matter what setting I'm in. And some days when it frightens me when I, oh my goodness, you know?
Yeah.
But to come into that and to know my daughter just changed life, left the country to a different life. And so we did a transit because, as you know, at Ritual, I love rituals.
Rituals,
so we did a
transition
ceremony for her on Saturday. And she was saying to me yesterday, Mom, so many people were touched. Like, you know, people thought they were just coming to get together. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't know you, right? But for me, every opportunity for healing is important.
Absolutely.
So even if we just took that little time out of this gathering to do a ritual that not only supports her in her transition, but heals in different ways. Everybody got their healing
absolutely
in different ways. Every opportunity to do that. So for me, I'm always teaching.
Yes.
Something.
Yeah. Mine is about love. It's just love. Love everyone.
Yeah.
Where they are.
Yeah.
I don't have any desire to fix people, change people, alter people. We have to do that for ourselves.
That's a whole lot of ego, eh? To think you could do that.
I know. And it was hard to get to this place where I could sit back and go, whether you take what I teach or not is none of my business. You're on a journey of which I don't live inside of you, so I cannot know what it is. But what I'm willing to do is love you right where you are. And you don't have to love me. You don't even have to like me. But I am going to love you. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter who it is or where. I'm always hugging people and kissing people. And one fellow in the congregation at the church where I work part-time, he said to me, "Does your husband mind that I'm hugging you all the time?" And I said, "No, not at all."
love the hugging.
Yeah,
love the hugging.
I think it's so important that we keep taking down our walls. Mm-hmm. That's the key to our freedom, but also the freedom of the world. The walls that are constructed are to keep people out and to create separation. And I was listening to an interview with Lady Gaga, and she was talking about, the snake or the serpent that comes in and plant seeds and separates us, because once we're separated, it's easier to conquer. Mm-hmm. And what we need to do and what you and I do is bring people together and begin to celebrate everyone in their authentic, glorious selves so that we can reveal to the world that it's the coming together that heals it, not the moving apart.
The Course in Miracles talk about that, right? Talks about the need. This is what the need for standardization is about, separation.
Yes, absolutely.
Because if there's always someone better than, then there's a rule, and and it continues to separate us.
Yes.
And think that, and all we need to do is to come together.
Yes.
Realize, accept, and honor everyone where they are.
Everybody.
And love them there.
Everybody. That's the interesting thing, and I did a little rant on my YouTube channel called Reality, and it is such an illusion when we look at, people go, well, we have to be realistic about. No, we don't. I moved to Toronto with $40 and a dream. I didn't have to live on the street. Everything I needed was there to support me. And was it challenging? Yeah, of course it was. But it was an opportunity for me to know that within me I had the ability to create something. And I have. The Center for Spiritual Living Toronto is still running today, 17 years later.
Exactly.
And
from a dream.
From a dream. And now I'm at Verity Center for Better Living, and I love being there. And again, it's a whole new community. It's a slightly different way of teaching new thought. But I love it. I love it so much because it feeds me. And then I can be in service as well, because I think we're only here to serve.
Yeah. And it's all... It seems so simple. It seems so simple because the laws are simple.
They are simple.
The laws of the universe are simple. So really it's about what's my desire, being clear on my desire, being really crystal clear, because the universe is going to say yes.
It says yes to all of it.
Every time.
Every time, yes.
Imagining it.
Yeah.
And then taking the steps.
Yeah.
Taking the step. And sometimes I see things realized in my life that I intended on 10 years ago.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
And it just finally, we have to be patient.
Yeah.
And just keep taking the steps. One step, just keep
whatever
putting
steps
one
in
step
front.
In, one foot in front of the other. As long as we're doing something every day towards what we desire.
And accepting every day with gratitude.
Gratitude.
it's so great. My daughter did a funny thing, my youngest daughter. When she was about 5 or 6, her and her girlfriend had a little lemonade stand out in front of the house. And she did this often because she's the entrepreneur, right? So, and she would always invite her friends to participate, and then she'd always split all the money with them, right? She never paid for the lemonade.
That's seed money.
Yeah, seed money. So she would set up one day, and she's looking at her little girlfriend, and she goes, wouldn't it be great if somebody gave us paper money? Because, of course, in Canada, you've got loonies and toonies,
right. Quarters. So paper money now, we know we're in the $5
bill. It's the $5 bill is the first place. So she says that to her friend. Not 2 or 3 minutes pass, a van pulls up. This woman hops out. She reaches in her pocket. She pulls out a $5 bill, puts it back, reaches in the other side, pulls out a 20, hands it to the girls and says, here, seed money for your business, hops back in the van and leaves. She didn't even buy a lemonade. And they were like, we got paper money, right?
Yeah.
They were so excited. Yeah. But that's how manifestation works.
It's so
simple. It's like, wouldn't this be great? And there it was.
I want this. I see it. Oh, my goodness. Here it is. Thank you.
Yeah.
And then remember to say thank you.
Thank you.
In our, we have several programs, but in our leadership program, regardless of what they are, we do 40-day processes, right?
Right. Mm-hmm.
Some love them and some get to love them. But one of them, of course, is about abundance.
Yes.
And what I've noticed, and of course, when we're doing the 40-day abundance process, the intention is right up front, right? Having very clear intention.
Yes.
And it's always just phenomenal to, and I've been doing this now, this program for 9 years.
Yes.
Almost 9 years. Or I don't even know. Since 2000.
Long time.
Long time. But what's really amazing, and we always do calls at 6 o'clock in the morning. That's usually when we do our calls. So for people who are planning to come to Sacred Women, that's one of the things that happen. But the amazing thing is to watch every year. I watch women; they get on the comms. Oh my goodness, I couldn't believe this happened. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness, oh my, and you know, keeping the manifestation journal and just seeing a thought become reality.
Yes,
within a day, within an hour.
Exactly.
Within 2 days, a thought. That's how simple it is.
Yeah.
But we have
thoughts
to be. Thoughts create.
Yeah.
And it's to be aware of how our thoughts are created and then to give thanks. That gratitude is crucial.
Well, I think one of the exercises that I give to most of my students is that at the end of every day, to think of the things to be grateful for. And to really look and don't write down the same thing every day. Oh, well, I'm alive. No, really think about your day and think about the person that you met or the experience that you overcame or whatever it was that for you stood out in that moment. I think of gratitude, and the most profound thing I am to have to be grateful for is one of my mother-in-laws. Been married a couple times.
Just a couple.
Yeah, five times a charm. But when I was married the second time, my husband and I were having challenges, and I had left, and I was staying with a friend for a while, and his mom phoned me up and said, would you come to church with me tonight? And so I went to that evening service. I didn't go to church. I wasn't raised with church. Church was just not on my radar at all. I had my own personal belief of God. But I was a raging, angry, frustrated young woman, and everything in my life was upside down, it seemed. Mm-hmm. So she invited me to go, and of course I really wanted her to like me, so I went. That was my justification for going. And something happened at that service where the speaker, it was a filmed presentation, but the speaker was a woman talking about death and dying. And I don't know what she said or what happened in that church that night, but it was literally like somebody had turned a light switch on. And for the first time in my life, I could see. And what I realized in that moment, what I felt, what I experienced, because it was such an epiphany, it was that God is love. And I stayed in that church for about a year and a half, but I wasn't getting that message. And I left and then eventually found the Center for Spiritual Living. And as soon as I found it, because I knew I was called to ministry, but not in the traditional sense, not in the you're a sinner and I'm a saint. I'm not a saint. And to sin is to make a mistake. And I'm pretty sure most of us have done that at least once, right?
Yeah.
I've done it a few times.
Just
I'm well
few.
Practiced at it.
Mm-hmm.
But every day I can learn from that and begin to make something different. But I have so much to be grateful for when it comes to that woman, because although our relationship was always a little bit strained, there was something about that moment, and she was the catalyst for taking me to the place that I needed to be. And regardless of what my reasoning was for going with her, the shift was completely transformative. And I think we can look at those things and go, can I get grateful for everything?
Yeah.
Can I get grateful? I remember in my first marriage, I got slapped around quite a lot. And he remarried years later, and my daughter told me that his wife had pushed him down the stairs or something. And I had a moment of, yes, karma. And then I went, oh my God, I don't wish that on anybody. And in that moment, I knew I'd forgiven. I knew I'd forgiven him. And it wasn't that I had set about, but when I had that moment of feeling good that he was hurt, I thought, that's not who I am. It's just not. And I was able in that moment to let it go. And his mother passed 2 years ago. I went to Calgary and did the memorial service for her. And it was my great joy to do it. She had asked me if I would do it when she found out I was becoming a minister. She, you know, this was like so many years ago, over 20 years ago when she asked me that. And so I phoned my daughter and I said, you know, Grandma asked me a long time ago if I'd do the service. What do you think your aunt and dad are going to think about that? But it was a beautiful experience, and I think it was a healing experience all the way around, because the woman they knew when I was 16 is not the woman that I am today.
Yeah.
And, you know, I felt very honored to be able to share the love that I had for my mother-in-law, my first mother-in-law.
You know, unforgiveness is violence.
It is violent.
It's poisonous. It's violent, and it really holds us back.
It obliterates the possibility of forward motion.
Yeah.
It absolutely stops us in our tracks.
Yeah. Often, you know, the first thing any client that I have, the first exercise they have to do is a forgiveness exercise, and it's a forgiveness exercise for themselves.
Yes.
Right. Forgiving themselves, and it's a shift. That's a cleanser, because whenever we're finding ourselves being stuck in anything, we might want to check in and see, what are we holding on to?
We are holding something. Yeah.
What are we holding on to that we need to release and forgive so we can move forward?
Yeah.
You know? And I know I do that check for myself too.
And I think it's a check we need to do regularly. It's not one that we do once and we're done. I think every day we can reflect on our day and go, what can I forgive myself for today? And as I've been trying to become a more patient driver, I have lots to forgive. So I get to the end of the day and I will forgive myself for the forgetfulness, where I forgot to be the patient driver. And, you know, wanted to curse someone out, because even if I didn't speak the words, they went through my mind. And then I get grateful for the fact that I'm now becoming aware. And so often I stop myself before it happens. And I know by doing that, there will come a point where I just won't do it at all. And I think that's where we're moving to, is how can I show up loving, compassionate, kind, and respectful all the time. Not occasionally, but all the time. Pierre and I, my husband, we did a workshop with my daughter's school last year for the grades 4, 5s, and 6s. And we taught compassion, kindness, and respect. I don't believe in anti-bullying. Somebody has to be wrong. But sometimes the kid that's bullying is hurting really badly and needs our love, right?
Usually.
So I wanted to teach them about compassion, kindness, and respect, because those are pivotal values that allow us to look at an individual who may be hurting. My friend Nancy, who was on last week, She is a food stylist and so, of course, does a lot of grocery shopping. Mm-hmm. And she shops a lot at one store, and she went in one time, and she always does self-checkout, or usually does self-checkout, and the woman who worked that area of the store was, she saw her all the time, they would say hello, whatever. And this one day she went in, and the woman was really kind of cranky, and, you know, she asked her a question, and she sort of, you know, whatever, no, it's fine, whatever, and she was just off, and Nancy said to her, are you okay? And she just ignored her and said, you know, blah, 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 whatever. And so she asked her again, I think she asked her about three times, are you okay? Mm-hmm. And the woman all of a sudden stopped and realized someone was seeing her and seeing her pain, whatever it was, because she knew this is not what this woman was like. This was not her natural way of being. Mm-hmm. And the woman broke into tears and said that her husband had died and it had only been a couple of weeks, but she had to move out of her apartment because she couldn't afford it on her own. Right. And so Nancy gave her a hug, and it's that type of compassion that when we see somebody acting out, they don't really need our condemnation. They really need our love. And we don't do that by saying your behavior is okay. We do that by trying to understand and then giving the gift of love. And I know it's challenging sometimes when people are mean to us or whatever, but I really believe love is the answer. It doesn't really matter what the question or circumstance.
It has to be. But Barbara, don't we have to be present though to even
present to do that? Yes.
To even do that, and we're moving so fast.
We have to slow down.
We're moving so fast.
Yeah.
One thing to the next thing to the next thing.
Yeah.
You know, and I know I often have to catch myself and say I just need to be still, because I can see, Nancy could not have seen that pain if she was moving so fast that this woman, you know?
That's right. She would have thought, oh, yeah. You know, she would have maybe in her mind cursed her out and taken her shopping and maybe gone to another store thinking, oh, I'm not shopping there anymore.
Compassion
is such a big thing. And we have to have it for ourselves. Yeah. We have to look at the fact that in each moment we're doing our best. In the Four Agreements, Don Miguel Ruiz writes about doing your best. Mm-hmm. So many women are perfectionists. Life isn't perfect. Life is messy. And within that mess, each day we can show up and do our best. I know with my daughter, my eldest daughter, I did my best. I was 16 when she was born. If I look back now, I'd say, whoa, I didn't do very good. Mm. But I have to accept I did my best in the moment with what I knew, what I believed about myself, and the value, or rather lack of value, I had for myself. And as I've grown, I am becoming a different woman, because I'm looking at me going, all the things that was labeled bad and wrong about me are just my natural attributes, like being loud, talking too much, all of these things that I was, you know, told as a kid, shut up.
Why you talk so much?
Why you talk so much?
When it's a gift. When it's a gift. Yes.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Exactly.
When it's a gift.
Well, and I think that's the thing, is most of us don't really recognize our gifts because we've been condemned for them in the past. Mm-hmm. But I want to thank you for coming on today, Aina-Nia.
Oh,
I love you so much.
I love you too.
And it's such a gift to have you here. And I'm pretty certain that something said or done is going to make a difference in someone's life today. For sure. There's no way it couldn't.
Guaranteed.
And I just want to say thank you for watching. Thank you for being here. If you're on my YouTube channel, please subscribe. And just know that you are a blessing in the world, that you are enough just the way you are. With all of the things about yourself that maybe you judge, condemn, or criticize, put that aside. Go within your heart. Find your authentic voice, the beauty and magnificence that God created. Somebody once said, God doesn't make junk, and I believe that. And God isn't something outside of us, but rather the divine energy within us. And so as New Thought teachers, we have lots to share, and I'm so grateful you are here today. You can get my books, any of the Journey books, at lulu.com or through my website, barbarashreinertrudel.com. 30 days to joy, 30 days of love, 30 days of forgiveness, and 30 days of gratitude. It is a process. It is a journey. Thank you for being you. Many blessings.